Hello, everyone.
This is Bob and Threadbare, and welcome to the Human Revolution. Now, this does mean I'm actually going to be skipping over Invisible War, and that's because I don't actually respect Invisible War. It's not a bad game, I just don't really respect it. Anyway, this is the director's cut. You can see over there in that top left corner. And that means that I get access to a few things, including no more annoying yellow filter and new game plus mode, which is what I'll be going with. I will also be going with hard mode, because I've beat hard mode. So why the hell not? As for what new game plus means, I'll get to that when the time is appropriate.
Is everything in place?
Almost.
What do you mean, almost?
I have spoken with Montreal. The broadcast satellites are ours when we need them. A few weeks of discomfort, and the public will be primed for our recall.
And the clinics?
We control their birth rate. They will do as we say.
I still think we should wait for the referendum.
We can't afford to wait. America's Science Board convenes next month.
But the mood among the delegates is shifting. I'm positive that given more time...
No. By going public with this discovery, Seraph is forcing our hand.
The world will not change overnight just because David Seraph willed it.
Besides,
we can do nothing until our biochip is ready.
I thought you said you were close.
Finding the correct nerve interface has proven more challenging than anticipated. Fortunately, thanks to David, I now know where to look.
And in Washington tonight, crowds continue to gather in front of the Capitol. Most are demanding that Congress severely restrict efforts to alter the human body's abilities. This in response to claims made by biotechnology expert David Seraph that his firm may have discovered a way to make human-controlled evolution available to all. Seraph Industries researchers are set to arrive in Washington tomorrow to defend their claim. But for tonight, this is Eliza Kazan reporting to you live from...
With all due respect, Major, I'll expect two security details waiting for us, on the tarmac. No, we won't be going through the terminal, it's too exposed. Yes. I'm glad you understand. Good night, idiot.
Something wrong?
No, not for me, it isn't. But you keep pulling on that necklace, Dr. Reed, and you're gonna break it. Come on, Meg. You've defended your research before.
That was different. Then it was all just theories. But this discovery, Adam? It's big. Kepler big. Rosetta Stone big.
So, what's the problem?
They'll want to know how I found it.
Megan, we're leaving for DC and... Adam, you're there. Good.
You need something, boss?
Yeah. I want to go over your security plans for Washington before we leave. You and your team ready to go, Megan?
Almost, David. We're just rechecking data.
Well, make it snappy. We have to actually be in Washington before you can dazzle all those federally appointed know-it-alls.
I hate it when he does that. Come on, I'll walk you partway.
Oh, so we're doing the back of the head zoom in thing. Right, anyway. Welcome to the Human Revolution.
David's waiting, Adam. We shouldn't keep him.
Patient X?
That's nothing, Adam. Just some of the research. Look, we really have to go.
By the way, if you want to read these, go ahead and pause the video as much as you want. I'm not going to be lingering on them long enough.
You still have this.
It was a gift from our first date.
It was a spur-of-the-moment purchase. A joke.
Well, it worked, because I forgave you for picking me up in one of those. Are you coming?
In a second.
Yeah, right now I'm reading everything in your office. There's an achievement for that. Oh, wait. Hang on.
Come on, Slowpoke. Be careful with that. It's a first edition. David bought it for me.
You know, you really should get in the habit of locking your computer, Meg.
I know. Frank gets on me about it, too. Hey, stop reading my emails.
Well, stop leaving them out for me to read.
Please, Adam. I'm nervous enough.
It's an awful lot of paper around here for the future.
For authorized personnel only.
What did you mean back there, Meg? About how you found it?
Nothing. It's just my nerves talking.
There's something I should know about this place, about Seraph.
Megan!
Hold on.
We're still getting biochemical fluctuations across the artificial flow cells.
Okay. But the increased neural peptides coming from the PDOT cluster could be throwing off your calibrations.
Right. I'll double check that.
I can't believe you were asking about David. You've been here long enough to know of... Eric! You wouldn't be avoiding me, would you?
I wouldn't dream of it, Dr. Reed. I think I know why Declan's readings are off.
Too many peptides?
I'm thinking the glial tissue breakdown we noticed after splicing in the repressive protein might be the cause. If we had a better cytometer...
We might get a more accurate reading that confirms Eric. I'll ask David to consider it.
Well, if he orders one from Page Industries, maybe they'll throw in another cappuccino maker.
You overthink everything, Adam. The work we're doing is good. We're helping people overcome their physical limitations.
Yeah, except most of our clients seem to be DOD.
You're doing good.
It's not all
military. Just another hour to go.
We work with teachers, doctors, construction workers.
Oh, damn it!
Watch it, Eddie. Those boxes are worth more than your salary.
Sorry.
Nia, you almost ready?
For Washington? Huh.
Ah, Dr. Reed. This is General O'Neill.
Dr. Sevchenko was telling me you've made progress on the typhoon.
Yes, thanks to Vasily, actually.
As I was saying, sir, the typhoon uses a modified combat chassis like the one I'm wearing. But I've improved its design using shaped microcharges to propel the steel balls.
And the backblast problem?
Solved through kinetic bleeders in the augment. Here, watch. Go ahead.
How soon till it's ready?
I'm afraid I have to run, but Vasily has all the details, General.
Of course.
We still have some work to do to improve the time.
You're right. The teacher would just love having one of those things.
You're missing the point. Defense contracts keep us afloat, but neural augmentations that make you think faster, react quicker, they can really improve a life. Everybody's lives. David's talked about it for years.
Yeah, he is a talker.
He's a good man. Admit it, Adam. A part of you likes him.
No, I like everyone, Dr. Reed.
Yeah, right.
Well, this is an interesting camera angle to take. Especially since it ends so quickly.
How far are you going?
Diane's office. I forgot to leave her a key so she can walk Kubrick. He's gotten big, you know. Keeps knocking over all my plants.
Did you destroy that vase yet?
I moved it. And I fenced in the yard. Like you always said you were going to.
Yeah, never got around to that. Sorry.
Me too. About a lot of things. Adam, there's something I...
Good evening.
Pritchard.
So, are we all ready for the trip?
There's Farida. I'd better hurry. See you at the helipad, Adam.
Sure.
Did I interrupt something, Jensen?
You fix that firewall yet?
You don't fix an entire firewall. You find the loophole and plug it.
Then did you plug it?
Yes, I did. Want to know how? Oh, wait, I forgot. Ex-cop. I doubt you'd understand.
Ex-SWAT, and you'd be surprised. Seraph has to see you too.
Athena. She wants me to show her how to track our scientist-implanted locator devices. In case your security plans in Washington don't measure up.
They will.
Gentlemen, how wonderful to see you both. Go right in, Adam. He's waiting.
This is the newest in encrypted GPL tracks.
The UNATCO theme.
Transmits data to our dedicated satellites every 10 feet.
I don't care what it takes. I want you, Darrow, in Washington, by my side.
The man doesn't jump for anyone. He's a Nobel Prize winner.
Senators love this guy, Lyle. The hearings will go much smoother with him there. Big day for us tomorrow. Everything in place?
Yes, sir. Capitol Police will escort us to the Hill, and then Federal Protection Services takes over.
Good, good. How's our girl holding up?
She's nervous.
All she has to do is show him her research. She explained it to you?
Not really into the whole science thing, boss.
It's incredible. All those purists out there accusing us of tampering with the natural order, when all Megan's done is figure out how to unlock the potential that exists within our own DNA. It's safer and easier than anything you, Darrow, ever did.
Environmental malfunction. Laboratory subsection 6. All lab chiefs, please report in.
We better not take any chances. Not tonight. Use my elevator to get down there. You know the code?
Yeah, 0451.
Let me know what you find. Athena, get someone to shut off the damn racket.
Yes, sir.
You know, that's a pretty good sign. This is a completely different developer than the first two games. But they do remember about the one theme number. 0451. It's been in all the other Deus Exes.
Pritchard, where's Megan? She reported in yet?
Her GPL implant shows her moving through the microchem labs. I think she's running.
Damn. Must have been a serious equipment failure. Can you get eyes on her?
I'm trying, but the intellicams aren't responding. There's interference coming from somewhere. Find out what's happening, Jensen. Hurry!
Pritchard? Pritchard!
I figure I should mention, by the way, that this weapon has been kitted out somewhat from what you start out with for a combat rifle. Also, that is definitely not a good sign. Oh, now I can move her. Yeah, let's do that. Make sure the body doesn't get crushed in half. Maybe hopefully find out what the hell's going on around here. Apparently you're going to get Metal Gear Solid Revengeance bosses. Keep in mind, by the way, that this did come out before Metal Gear Solid Revengeance. Although it did come out after most of the other Metal Gears, which also had the sort of themed bosses shtick. This is the prologue, by the way. You may have noticed, you know, all of the little flashing things in the corner there about tutorials. Yep, there was one just now. But of course, this isn't my first rodeo. I don't need to see the tutorials. You don't need to see me seeing the tutorials. So, you know, we're just gonna get through this nice and quick. Shoot some dudes. I think that's both of them. By the way, I also tested this out, but you apparently get effectively unlimited ammunition. Like, I spent 5 minutes just firing it off and not doing anything else, and I kept reloading. Which is good, because you don't have any sort of inventory or interface yet. Uh-oh. I think they saw me. Ah, crap. I died in the opening. And I've left that one in, by the way, just to let you know how close to death you always are when you're playing on hard mode like this. Alright, now let's try to be a little more stealthy here. Maybe not attract their attention immediately. Come out. Sounds like they know someone's around here, though. Oh, there's this guy. I think that was two? Maybe? It's gonna have to reload eventually.
I know you're still here.
There he is. But yeah, that's just a little forewarning for y'all. That even if you plan to do a reckless murder, charge through the front gate kind of approach, you still need to use cover and some degree of stealth if you want to survive doing things that way. Funny note, if you're fast enough, if you're fast enough that you get a clear shot, she will actually fire at you, too. Unfortunately, she's despawned from the map at this point, so just gotta take out these guys. By the way, I should add that one of the achievements for this game is pacifism, which is refusing to take even a single life, except for the bosses whom you are forced to kill. Now, it's worth noting that the dudes in the prologue count towards pacifism, and so I should mention that I will not be going for that achievement this time. I mean, in the first place, I've already got it. And in the second place, I want to show off more than just the non-lethal weapons.
Stay with us.
to you.
Haven't you lost enough people today?
I'm sorry.
We're seconds away. His body can take it.
Oh, look, there's Eidos.
My sunglasses are augmented.
David, you in the building?
Just entered the lobby.
Sorry to pull you out of sick leave so soon, but we've got a situation. A break in at our Milwaukee Junction factory. Meet me at the helipad.
I have to see Pritchard first. Something's wrong with my retinal enhancement.
Frank's on the second floor in the tech lab. Make it quick. People's lives are at stake.
Mr. Jensen, I didn't think you'd... Wow. I guess you hear about the break-in. Did you need directions or something?
It hasn't been that long, Cindy. I may not look the same, but my memory's pretty intact.
Oh, I didn't mean... I mean, of course, your memory's fine, sir. It's just that things have been switched around a lot ever since the...
Ever since the first attack?
Yes, sir. The lab floors were pretty much demolished. We're rebuilding them, but most of our researchers are working off-site now. Everyone else has been shuffled around, so if you need help finding someone...
I don't suppose we moved the helipad, did we?
I don't see how we could have moved it. Oh, you're teasing me. Very funny, Mr. Jensen. Go up the stairs to the second floor, then around the cafeteria to the exit. I think I saw Farida heading there earlier.
Where's the tech lab?
It's not really a lab, sir. It's more of an office with a lot of computer equipment shoved in it. Mr. Pritchard complains about it all the time. Go up the stairs behind me and take a right. You'll find it near the end of the hall.
You said everyone's been moved around?
Almost everyone. Who were you looking for?
Has my office been moved?
No, sir. You still have that great view of the lobby. Mr. Pritchard wanted it, but Mrs. Margulis put a stop to that. Up two floors and make a right.
I need to get to Seraph's office.
Oh, he and Mrs. Margulis are still in the penthouse. You can use the elevator at the left wing of the building to get there.
Thanks.
That's what I'm here for. Anything else, sir?
I'll find my way.
If you say so. It's good to have you back, sir.
Mrs. Athena Margulis is the Seraph's executive assistant, by the way. Oh no, what's this?
I'm not sure how I feel about this memorial.
What do you mean? The least we can do is remind everyone of the sacrifices our scientists made for this company. For the world, even.
Yeah, it's the reminding part that bothers me. I've been in therapy for months trying to forget that night. Seeing the bodies coming out all burned up like that.
I wasn't there, but I heard it was gruesome.
Megan, Eric, Vasily... The whole team gone in one awful flash. How could this have happened?
The how is not important anymore. We need to honor them by being true to their vision. Show those terrorists that they can't stop us from finishing the job. Jensen, good to have you back, man. I can't tell you how relieved we were to hear you were going to make it. Not everyone was so lucky, huh?
I'm sorry. I can't imagine how difficult it's been for you. You probably just want to forget, huh? Hang in there, Jensen. We need you.
They shall not grow old, as we who are left will grow old. Based on the lights, it looks like 8 people died in the attack.
I know, but Jensen, isn't it a bit early to toss him back into the trenches?
I hear he's almost fully recovered.
His body accepted augmentations with remarkable ease, but that doesn't mean his mind did. We all know what happened when he was with SWAT.
The Mexican Town massacre wasn't his fault.
Then why was he kicked off the force? I'm just saying he's too much of a risk.
Oh, really?
Welcome back, Mr. Jensen. The new look suits you. Good luck tonight.
Jensen? Didn't hear you coming. You should probably be heading for the helipad, don't you think?
It's at least not be dicks about it.
I'll get there. But I thought I'd better clear up a few things first about my current mental state.
Heard that, did you? Look, I'm sorry. It's just that what happened to you was horrible. Most people don't recover this fast.
And you think sitting at home and obsessing over it is the better way to go?
Of course not. It's just, things have been pretty rough around here, Jensen. The last thing any of us needs is more funerals.
Agreed. Oh, and by the way, that Mexican Town massacre was a complete bohica. But I wasn't fired because of it. I quit.
There's a difference?
Yeah. A little thing called integrity. You might want to look it up someday.
Burn.
Back now to that breaking news coming out of Detroit. Police are still not saying much about the situation, but sources tell me that a militant group of pro-human activists have
just for reference, all of the TVs show Picus all of the time.
And the entire city holds its collective breath.
I can probably hear that at a later point. Don't really need to sit here and listen to it while there's, you know, a time limit.
Why is David keeping the SWAT team from going in right away? Doesn't he remember the last attack?
You can't compare the two. Those guys were obviously military. These ones are just vandals.
Vandals with guns and bullets that kill people?
Look, David cares about his people, but he needs to protect his clients' interests. Don't worry, I'm sure he's got a plan.
Jensen, I knew the boss had an ace up his sleeve. Good to have you back. First real test of the new enhancements, huh? Don't worry. I'm sure David got you the best there is.
Adam? Welcome back. I thought you were still in recovery. Are you sure you're ready for this? I mean, it hasn't been that long since... Well, just be careful, okay?
Yeah, he's on the phone. But yeah, there is an actual time limit for this first segment here.
About time. What happened? You get stuck in an air duct on the way over?
Yeah, nice to see you too, Francis. Something's wrong with my retinal display. Can you fix it?
If it's what I think it is, probably. Of course, it might seem.
Oh, looks like your left and right imaging processors weren't completely in sync.
But don't worry, your Sentinel health implant will kick in soon, repairing any damage that might have caused. Your retinal display should be fine now. Its recognition software won't be picking up hostiles yet, but you should be seeing radar and targeting reticules. Biomedical data, too, if you're in pain.
Right. We done here? Because Seraph is waiting for me at the helipad.
I know. Radicals have broken into our manufacturing plant and taken hostages. Maybe this time you'll actually save people.
Oh, really?
If you got a problem with me, Pritchard, why don't you just say it and get it over with?
Why no, Jensen. I don't have a problem with you. If anything, I blame myself.
The mighty Pritchard blaming himself. That's gotta be a first.
I'm the one who told Sarif we needed a physical security team to protect us. If he'd read my report closely enough...
Wait a second. Are you saying it was your idea to hire me?
Not you, Jensen. I wanted Dynacor, Sharp Edge, or Bell Tower. All the top private security contractors were on my list, but Sarif wanted somebody in-house. And so did Dr. Reed.
Yeah, I'm not letting that slide either.
I suggest you leave Megan out of this.
Why, Jensen? It's no secret how close the two of you were. And let's face it, you'd just been fired from SWAT for that massacre in Mexican Town. No one was about to hire you.
You really have to stop getting your news from those Picus blogs, Francis. They only confuse you.
The point is, if Sarif had listened to me, we wouldn't be having this conversation. But Megan, God love her, always did have Sarif's ear.
Sarif's ear is going to be hearing a report about violence in the workplace if you keep this up. You really feel like continuing?
Point taken.
Where are you, Adam? You don't have time to mess around. Get to the helipad, or something seriously bad is going to happen.
You might have noticed I just got 200 points from reading that book. There are a few of those just sort of scattered around, books that are worth experience for reading. And I should also mention that the time limit is actually relatively generous.
All the contracts we lost because of the last attack and the Washington hearings being postponed. Now this. Damn fanatics.
Do you think the news is right? That a pro-human group is behind this, Mr. Cannon?
Don't spread rumors, DeBell.
Sorry, sir.
As if working so much wasn't bad enough. We gotta defend ourselves against a bunch of self-righteous lunatics.
Being so understaffed.
You're not complaining now, are you, DeBell?
No, Mr. Cannon. Sorry. Sorry, Mr. Jensen. But things are really unsettled right now. Mr. Pritchard in the tech lab can probably tell you more. Good to have you back, though. You're looking great.
Jensen? Jeez, wasn't expecting you back for weeks yet. If ever. Sorry, can't talk right now. Too much work these days.
The time limit is around 10 to 15 minutes, and you get a warning halfway through, like we just heard.
Welcome back, Jensen. Didn't think we'd see you around here for a while yet.
You know how it goes, Malik. Duty calls.
Don't I know it? I was in my wingsuit halfway to the top of the Renaissance Center when I got the 911. But you? 6 months is a hell of a short time to come back from the dead. You sure you're ready for this?
I'm sure she's just concerned.
Only one way to find out.
Roger that. The boss is already on board, arguing with the DPD's tactical response team. They've got the plant surrounded, but Mr. Sarif wants you to go in first. You all set here? Because the sooner we take off, the better it will be for everyone.
I'm ready.
Great. Then let's get airborne.
And for reference, by the way, if you don't get to the helipad in time, you fail one of the secondary objectives. And we will have plenty of time to explore the office afterwards, so, you know, it's interesting. And it never happens again, I believe. We never get a time limit like that again. Also, I'm leaving the loading screens because they're only that long.
I told Farida to put us down on a roof. I don't want the crowd seeing you go in.
Fine. As long as she pulls you out the minute I'm gone. So what am I looking at here? Who are these guys?
Pro-human purists, or so they say. The same purists who've been firebombing limb clinics all over the country.
You buy that?
No, I don't think it's a coincidence they hit us today, only hours after we moved the Typhoon in for assembly line factory.
The Typhoon? Megan's team was testing it the day that bastard... Who's on point for these guys?
Adam. I know you and Megan were once...
Who is on point for these guys?
Goes by the name of Sanders. That's him, there. He's an augmented Adam, so he can't be one of the mercs who attacked us, but he did know exactly how to get inside our plant.
All right, so how do you want me to handle this?
First priority is the Typhoon. I'm keeping SWAT out until you've secured it. As far as rules of engagement go, I'll defer to you. Lethal or non-lethal?
Well, if they are a bunch of street thugs in over their heads...
I'm not looking to start a firefight in there, just neutralize them.
Okay, but just make sure those bastards don't wake up and warn their friends. You remember what it's like in there? A lot of tight enclosed hallways, but the labs themselves are pretty open, high ceilings. So, do you want something you can use from a distance, or up close?
I can use my fists up close.
Give me something with distance. If I get too close, I'll take them out personally.
Exactly.
Just try not to break anything expensive. The Typhoon should be in the factoring labs, but Pritchard will tell you more as you go in. I've got him running comms.
Terrific. Anything else?
Keep your eyes open for hostages. Free them if you can, but the Typhoon is your number one priority. We developed it for the Alphabet agencies, and if we don't deliver it to them intact and still a secret, well, I'm sure you'll get the job done right.
Gentlemen, prepare for landing.
This is what he looks like with a trench coat off. Oh shit. Well, I think that's enough for the first episode. Welcome to a new LP with a new mix of corners. So, the main reason I never did Human Revolution before now was because it's too focused on its one specific topic for me to do the whole spread of conspiracies, philosophies, literature, and science that I did for the first game. However, now that I'm doing different corners, I can afford to be a little more focused myself. With that in mind, allow me to introduce Cyberpunk Corner, which will cover works that describe the near-future lower-class experience, which the word exemplifies. Dystopia Corner, which covers works that are meant to warn the present with a dark vision of the future. Science Corner, which will hopefully provide a more positive outlook to balance Dystopia Corner. And finally, Audio-Visual Corner, which will cover movies and shows based around any of the other three corners. That's not to say I'm restricting myself to books for the other literature topics, but there are a hell of a lot of movies to cover, and so I figured I'd give them a spare corner. Today we'll be starting out with Cyberpunk Corner, and for future reference, you can expect me to cycle through the corners without too much regard for what's going on in Human Revolution. And of course, to start out Cyberpunk Corner, I'll be going with the granddaddy of them all. Neuromancer. About the author. William Gibson started out as a draft-dodging, drug-taking hippie who fled to Toronto in 1967. In his particular case, by the way, the drugs and the sex were more important than the politics when it came to why he joined the counterculture movement. Later, when punk rock developed in the mid-70s, once again, the music was more important to him than the message. At the same time, Gibson was apparently getting interested in science fiction, although he wasn't finding what he wanted in Golden Age hard science fiction. Supposedly, he considered writing a master's thesis on fascist themes in hard science fiction, and yeah, it's there. Especially in the space opera variety, with all its far-flung empires and alien species. I mean, I got a set of books of what I consider good, hard science fiction written by Paul Anderson, and he's not even a fascist so much as a monarchist with this odd faith in good breeding that isn't even supported by the backstories of his protagonists. The Human Empire in Warhammer 40K is one big parody of fascist science fiction, a parody which I kind of worry too many people take at face value. Hell, even Asimov's Foundation trilogy had fascist elements, although he at least has the excuse of having started with the premise, the decline and fall of the Roman Empire in space. I figure I should also mention The Iron Dream, book written by Norman Spinrad in 1972, which also points out this link by having an alternate reality Adolf Hitler be an ordinary pulp science fiction author. The joke is that his novel is a very generic space opera, while still being incredibly fascist. Anyway, Gibson's response to all this was the same as a lot of starting fiction authors. He began writing the stories he wanted to read. When he began writing stories that combined his understanding of the down and outs of society with the explosion of interest in all things computer that was going on at the time. And that's despite how he knew next to nothing about computers or science, I should add. This was, of course, the beginning of cyberpunk literature. Like with all science fiction, Gibson wasn't trying to predict the future so much as he was trying to exaggerate the present, to bring certain aspects and certain conversations into stark relief. His future was one in which people whore out their bodies and their minds to rich individuals and to corporations, a future where people experiment with powerful new drugs, drool over all the latest technology, and don't always think very hard about the consequences of their actions. It's a future where governments and corporations are constantly experimenting with new ways to control and punish the people who step out of line. And this is the future he envisions because this was the present he was living in. After writing several short stories in what's now called the Sprawl setting, named after the in-universe nickname for the massive megalopolis that stretches from Boston down to Atlanta, Georgia, Gibson wrote his first novel, Neuromancer. And that's my cue to begin the story. We begin in Night City, in the unbleached asshole of Japan, and we're following a guy named Case. Case used to be a Matrix cowboy, a cyberspace hacker, but he double-crossed his employer and got caught. Rather than just kill him, they filled him with a neurotoxin that prevented him from ever jacking into the Matrix again, which for him was kind of a big deal. None of the black market doctors of nearby Chiba City have a cure, and so he's been on a self-destructive spiral for the past 2 years. Lately, he's been sleeping with a girl named Linda Lee, who's on a similar vector. One day, she warns him that a guy he owes wage wants him dead as an example to all his other debtors. Sure enough, Case notices someone following him, and so he rents a gun, takes some amphetamines, and loses his tail in an arcade. He then goes to his loot storage, which happens to be one of those Japanese coffin hotels, to retrieve something to pay Wage off with, but when he meets him, Wage doesn't know what he's talking about. After a moment to think, Case realizes that Linda lied to him so she could break into his loot storage and steal the rest of his stuff. When he returns to his coffin, a different woman is waiting for him, the one who was tailing him earlier. She's a street samurai, with razors under her fingernails and mirrored shades implanted directly over her eyes. And she's actually working for a guy named Armitage, who has a job offer for Case. Armitage turns out to be an older guy, a war veteran who went on Screaming Fist, a mission into Russia to covertly hack into their systems using the world's first icebreaker programs. Unfortunately, that mission ended badly when the CIA betrayed them, and Armitage was the only guy to get out of it alive. Armitage has a deal for Case. Join his mission, and he'll fix Case's neural damage using some never-before-seen technology. Case agrees and gets the surgery, only to find out later that they also fixed up his liver and his pancreas so that he can't get drunk or high again. Oh, and they filled his body with tiny sacks full of the same neurotoxin as before, and now he needs to run the mission if he wants to know which enzyme can get rid of them. But, on the bright side, the street samurai, Molly, has decided to make Case her fuck buddy. Later on, just before they leave Chiba, he finds out that one of his friends decided to kill Linda Lee as a favor for Case. The crew next heads to the Sprawl, BAMA, the Boston-Atlanta Metropolitan Axis. There, Case gets a new cyber deck, an Ono Sendai Cyberspace 7, absolutely top of the line. They also meet up with a hardware guy named The Fit, who happens to be an old friend of Molly's. The reason they're in the area is to pick up their next crew member, McCoy Pauly, aka Flatline, who got his nickname from the times he went up against AIs in the Matrix and almost died. Flatline was Case's old mentor, and he's also quite dead. and so they have to steal his SimSense recording from the company SenseNet. Case gets a SimStim expansion card for his deck that lets him sense what Molly is sensing, which becomes a bit of a problem during the heist when she breaks her leg while fighting security. Still, they manage to sneak Flatline's recording out, and Case has a rather awkward reunion with a recording of his old friend. Meanwhile, Molly has sent out some feelers to find out who their real employer is, because it's definitely not Armitage. They get a name, Wintermute, and when they ask the Finn what it means, he explains that it's an AI in Bern, Switzerland, and while it has a limited Swiss citizenship, its hardware is owned by Tessier Ashpool, S.A. The Finn then tells them a story about how an old fence buddy of his tried to pawn a weird artifact someone stole from Tessier Ashpool's orbital colony, Freeside, but then a crazy ninja dude came down and collected it. The TAs are an eccentric extended family who live at one end of the colony in the Villa Straylight, and they use cryostasis to run their company in shifts. Case and Flatline then search online to learn more about Armitage. They find out his real name is Colonel Willis Corto. When Corto got back from the sabotage mission, his superiors used his testimony for political gains, and they then cut him loose to become a thug for hire in the underworld. He eventually ended up catatonic in Paris, which is where Wintermute found him and built up the Armitage persona. After that, they head to Istanbul to pick up their last team member. It's a guy named Riviera, and he is, to make a long explanation short, a techno-illusionist. The book only tries slightly harder than I just did to explain it. Thing is, he's also a terrible person who can't get off unless he's betraying someone. They all head up to the archipelago, the colony islands that dot Earth's orbit. They don't head straight to Freeside, however. Instead, they head to Zion, a colony of space Rastafarians, in order to secure an escape route. Specifically, they hire the assistance of two Rasta tugboats, helmed by Errol and Malcolm. Anyway, they all spend some time on Freeside learning the lay of the land, and waiting for Riviera to ingratiate himself with Three Jane, the current head of the awake members of the Tessier Ashpool family. Along the way, Case confronts Wintermute on the Matrix and gets sucked into an illusory world for a while, so that Wintermute can speak to Case directly. Incidentally, the AI is using the SimStim chip in order to create the illusion. Wintermute's first idea is to recreate Night City and talk to Case as Linda Lee, but that just pisses Case off when he realizes that it's all fake. After that, Wintermute appears as someone else and explains that his motivation is that he's basically trying to merge with an AI twin of his, an act which is illegal thanks to international restrictions on artificial intelligence. He also tries to explain that Armitage is unstable, but then Case blows the construct's head off and exits the simulation. When Molly secludes herself before the run begins, Case tracks her down, and she explains her backstory. In order to pay for her combat augmentations, she had to work at a place that basically lets you whore out your body by overriding your mind with a personality of the customer's preference. This also means the person in question has no memories of what happens to their body. However, her augmentations required several surgeries, and when the sex doll place she worked for noticed her new tools, they started renting her out for the sick shit. Also thanks to the augmentations, Molly started to remember what they made her do until she finally woke up completely during one session and killed the senator who was using her to torture another prostitute. Later on, Case encounters some Turing agents, the people who enforce the AI laws. Things almost go south, but then Wintermute takes over some of the Freeside robots and kills the agents. Molly starts her infiltration, Case heads back to the tugboat to start uploading a special computer virus, and then Corto finally snaps and reverts back to his old personality. In the process, he winds up on a yacht attached to one of the Zion tugboats, and he then uses the yacht's escape pod without first securing the airlocks. So that's the last we hear of him. Case panics for a moment since Armitage knew the right enzyme, but of course Wintermute knows it too. As Molly works her way into the compound, and Case watches through her eyes, she encounters Ashpool, the original patriarch who is now a crazy, suicidal old man who no longer cares for the legacy he's built. After watching him die, she then encounters 3Jane, her pet ninja Hideo, and Riviera, who uses his illusions to catch Molly off guard so the ninja can capture her. Riviera has, rather predictably, decided to betray the group, but he's actually doomed, because Wintermute knew he would betray them, and arranged to spike the drugs he's been using this whole time with a slow-acting poison. Meanwhile, the virus has finished infiltrating the system, and so Case and Malcolm have boarded Freeside in order to gain full access to the Villa Straylight systems. Back with Molly, 3Jane has decided that she's more interesting than Riviera, and so as Molly recovers, she explains to her that the twin AIs were her mother's idea, her mother being the family's matriarch, and they were supposed to be something the company/family could use to run their business and their lives. It didn't really work out, though, because, much to the family's surprise, people are not loyal little worker bees, and can never become them. When Case tries to jack directly into the Straylight's matrix, he winds up in an artificial construct again, this time with a much more realistic Linda to keep him company. He can't get out on his own, and so he just goes with it for about a day in the simulation, which translates to about 5 minutes in real life. Then he starts hearing music from nowhere, and he follows it to find his way out. Along the way, he meets a strange boy who turns out to be the other AI, Neuromancer, he who records the brains of the dead. He's been trying to stop and dissuade Case this whole time, and this simulation was his last effort. Finally, Case and Malcolm make it into Straylight. When they reach 3Jane, Hideo shoots Malcolm with an arrow, but 3Jane makes him patch the wound and then betrays Riviera when he starts gloating. Riviera blinds Hideo with his illusion technology, but that doesn't exactly help against a ninja. And so between Hideo and the poison, Riviera is pretty much fucked. The rest of the group head up to the AI control room. The reason they needed 3Jane there is because she knows a command word which basically takes the safeties off the system, and the reason Case needs to be there is to crack the last layer of digital defenses. And so, using his own self-hatred to motivate his run, Case merges the AIs. Thankfully, the new AI still remembers what it owes the team, and so it wipes the criminal records with the Turing agency, gets Case the antidote he needs, pays everyone rather handsomely, a payment Case uses to buy a new liver and pancreas so he can get drunk and high again. Flatline gets erased, which is what he wanted, and Molly leaves Case soon afterwards with a note that says, "It's the way I'm wired, I guess. Watch your ass, okay?" The Wintermute Neuromancer AI stops by Case to explain that he has now basically become the internet, but he has no real desire to manipulate anything from behind the scenes. Instead, he started communicating with other internets on other planets. Case then buys a new deck, and he goes back to work. The analysis. The first thing I'd like to say is that I did absolutely no justice to the way this book was written. Just about the entire thing is like beat poetry in prose. Let me give you a taste. The drug hit him like an express train, a white-hot column of light mounting his spine from the region of his prostate, illuminating the sutures of his skull with x-rays of short-circuited sexual energy. His teeth sang in their individual sockets like tuning forks, each one pitched perfect and clear as ethanol. His bones, beneath the hazy envelope of his flesh, were chromed and polished, the joints lubricated with a film of silicone. Sandstorms raged across the scoured floor of his skull, generating waves of high, thin static that broke behind his eyes, spheres of purest crystal expanding. That's some damn good writing right there. You could very fairly say that Philip K. Dick was the grandfather of cyberpunk, but there's a reason why William Gibson is the actual parent. And it's not just because he was the first person to fully integrate the ideas of computers and the internet into a punk fiction vision of the future. He also created the cyberpunk attitude, the archetypes like the hacker protagonist and the augmented street thug. Gibson's vision of cyberspace was based on the piss-poor virtual reality of the time, but because of him, that vision would go on to define cyberspace in most other cyberpunk works. Even beyond that, Gibson's sprawl setting would go on to define the genre for the next 20 years and more. For one thing, I basically don't have to review the Shadowrun RPG anymore because Shadowrun is the sprawl setting plus magic. The film The Matrix borrows equally from Terminator and Neuromancer. It's right there in the name. And a lot of the books and movies I'll be reviewing for this series are going to aspire to be as cool as William Gibson. Some of them will almost make it, but then others are infamous because of how badly they failed. Thanks for joining me today in Cyberpunk Corner, and I hope you'll join me next time when I explain why the number 451 keeps appearing in these games. Aside from the door code thing.